Now to our breaking news story, major rescue efforts underway to save a miner trapped underground following a mine collapse in regional Victoria. A second worker who suffered injuries was flown to hospital last night and is currently fighting for life.
Joining us for more is Arnold Dix, the Victorian engineer who brought 41 Indian miners back to safety in November of last year. Who could forget that? Mm. Arnold, good morning to you. Look, can you give us an idea on the complexities of this rescue operation?
Yeah, well, here we go again. It's, of course, incredibly dangerous situation when you've got a collapse underground. As you know, you've got one miner fighting for his life now after receiving the injuries overnight or yesterday afternoon. And, of course, one man still trapped there. These are incredibly difficult conditions to be working in. There's been the collapse. The actual mine itself is blocked. Thankfully, 25 workers have been lifted out through a ventilation shaft. So that's 26 of 27 out, but certainly with one man still trapped. You know, this is very, very serious situation. And the area that they're trapped in, this type of mining operation, is in what's known as a fault zone, similar in some ways to what we were dealing with up in the Himalayas. And, rescuers will be literally, again, going millimetre by millimetre, again, making sure they don't trigger a collapse, again, making sure they're safe, and, of course, getting that last miner out alive. Very difficult task.
I mean, Arnold, give us a sense of what it's like underground in those tunnels. You know, we're talking 500 metres underground. We've got falling rocks. You know this environment better than most. This is going to be challenging. And then I guess it raises concerns about why they were under there in these kinds of circumstances.
No, I think mining's mining. And so if you want a gold necklace, if you want a gold ring, if you want jewellery, if you want electronics, we have to do mining. And mining has always some risk. And that's what we're seeing here. Thankfully, we're in Australia and our mines are incredibly safe by world standards, but it's still mining and it's still underground. And at 500 metres underground, the forces of the, you've got 500 metres of mountain, or in this case, rock above you, you're under Ballarat. There's a lot going on, and that's why you'll see there's reference to the geotechnical engineers, the geophysicists. They'll be down there doing the calculations to make sure as they do the rescue, as they're removing some of the rock that's fallen, they don't trigger a further collapse. And that's to protect, of course, the person who's trapped and also themselves. And this is this balancing thing again.
Look, they may not even know. Given those circumstances you're outlining and how painstakingly slow it's going to go, they may not know exactly the status of the miner who is trapped at the moment. All that is incredibly difficult. Is it possible to put a time frame on it? What would conditions be like?
No.
Just from a breathing perspective?
No. Yeah, so time frames, absolutely. No, you can't put a time frame on it. In terms of the circumstances the last trap miner finds themselves in, we don't know exactly what's around them. They might be trapped, it might be their ankle that's trapped and that might be all, but if the collapse has gone around them, then you don't want to disturb the rock mass at all, because your ability to breathe, of course, is dependent upon the pressure that you're under. So it's like microsurgery they're doing at the moment to get this man out. Now, the good news is that of all the countries and all the places for this to happen, we are some of the, well, us and the South Africans, the best miners, the best rescue teams, the best emergency services. So I'm confident that whatever can be done will be being done. And this is serious. Like this, it's the same story again.
Okay.
And they're very, very difficult.
We appreciate you shedding some light on this difficult story. And look, there are a couple of families out there who are really doing it tough this morning. Our thoughts are with them. Race is on right now to free one miner still trapped underground following the collapse of a gold mine in regional Victoria. A second worker who was rescued last night is currently fighting for life in hospital. For more, let's bring in Bill Shorten, who worked as Secretary of the Australian Workers Union during the Beaconsfield mine disaster, and also the Ballarat Mayor. Bill, to you first up, this all brings back some tough memories, doesn't it, of Beaconsfield? What have you heard this morning from the ground?
Well, first of all, my thoughts are with the men who were on the shift yesterday afternoon. They will be shocked, they will be grieving. And my thoughts are also with the rescuers who, no doubt as we speak, are doing their absolute best to find their final missing workmate. So that's what I think. I think about the people involved there. My old union, the Australian Workers Union, has been present since late yesterday afternoon. Apparently the emergency warnings and the call for emergency service, I should say, went out sometime just before 5 p.m. I've spoken to the Secretary of the Union, Ronnie Hayden, who's in Ballarat as we speak. I think you're talking to him later this morning. The men are shocked, they're grieving. The union is reaching out to them and will no doubt be talking to them further in coming days. I understand there's a meeting with WorkSafe officials in the coming next couple of hours as well.
All right, I'll get onto that in just a second. But we know the conditions, they're pretty tough, aren't they? It's painstaking work, working through that rubble.
Well, yeah, I'll never forget one of the finest moments of my life was when I was in front of the mine superintendent's sort of office in Beaconsfield, and some of the authorities wanted to assume that the missing miners were dead. And I remember these gritty underground miners saying, until we can find the bodies, it's a rescue, not a recovery. The conditions will be very volatile. I can't verify, but I'm told that the men were about 3 kilometres into the mine. Beaconsfield was a shaft mine where you go down a giant sort of lift. Mm-hmm. This is a drive-in mine in parts. So they'll be very, we don't know what's caused the rockfall, this catastrophic rockfall. A lot of questions to be answered, mm-hmm. but it'll be very hazardous circumstances, which means that the men doing the rescuing are brave. They mightn't see themselves as brave. They'll just see themselves as looking out for their workmate. But they're brave.
There is, that's for sure. It's such a tough job, isn't it? And look, that operation is still underway. It is early days to look at the safety of mining practices, but it is not the first collapse at this mine. 27 miners were trapped in 2007, and there was a collapse as recent as 2021. How do you approach that?
Well, I know that the AW will be incredibly diligent. I'm not sure what morale's like. I think for the purposes of today, the focus has to be on the rescue of the missing workmate. There will no doubt be all sorts of investigations. Our thoughts are also with the young injured man at the Alfred. Alfred's one of the best hospitals in the world, so he's getting the best care possible, which is great. There will be all sorts of inquiries to go through this. And one thing's for sure, we will hear from the men who worked in that mine. The mine had been, it's a matter of record that the mine had been in administration and new management's come in very early this year. As I understand it, the men were doing a form of mining called airleg mining. But I think the big priority today is the psychology of the survivors and the rescuers' attempts to get to the final missing man, miner.
No doubt the families, the miners and the whole community will want some answers at some point, Bill. Thank you. Let's bring in the Ballarat man now, Des Hudson. Des, tough night for you all. How's the community holding up?
Yeah, thanks, Carl. As I've said over the last little while, we have a very resilient community, a community that certainly regularly shows empathy for other members of our community when they're going through a tough time. And that's what those that are involved in the mine site are absolutely in at the moment. And certainly all our thoughts and prayers and best wishes go to that miner that is still trapped and to the emergency services that will be working feverishly to try and be able to extract the miner as quickly as possible and bring him to the surface. But we also lend our thoughts to that particular miner who is in the Alfred Hospital in Melbourne with significant injuries, and we hope and pray that there can be a speedy recovery for him, but also the family of everyone who is involved, of both the trapped miner, the miner that is now in hospital, and others that will be having an anxious time while the rest of the rescue unfolds, and hopefully we can get a positive outcome.
A couple of families in deep trauma and also pain this morning. We appreciate you both being on. Thank you, Sarah.